So these are five lessons that I learned from the book Rich Dad Poor Dad. And by the way, I've actually read this book at least three times. If you haven't read it, I would highly suggest that you pick up the book. I've done audiobooks before, and this is what I used to always do. But when I transitioned into actually reading the book, it's completely different. So I highly suggest it. So with that said, let's go into number one. The very first thing is do not work for money. Now, you know, you've probably heard Robert Kiyosaki talking a lot about investing your money and making sure that your money doesn't sit in your bank account. And although I agree with that to a certain extent, but one very important thing that you have to keep in mind here is that Robert Kiyosaki's main business is real estate and investing in things like crypto and stocks and stuff like that. He doesn't have a job or a business that he runs while he does those things. This is his main thing. It's kind of like Warren Buffett. He's not an investor on the side. He's not a day trader. What he is he buys big chunks of companies, of very big companies, and that's how he makes his money, right? So that's very important for you to understand, because I see a lot of people with, you know, they have $5,000 or $10,000 or $15,000 in their bank account while they have a job and probably even trying to side hustle. And they're like, well, I've got money sitting in the bank and it's earning zero. I want to invest that. I want to put it somewhere. But you see, this was me a couple of years ago. I had about $150,000 or $200,000 in the bank. And, you know, it was growing at about $5,000 or $10,000 per month for a few months now. And I was looking at it and I said, you know, I was like, man, this money is sitting here and it's losing value due to inflation about 1 to 3% per year. And it's earning zero. You know, I could probably invest it in some vehicles. But then what I realized is that I was taking 10, 15 hours every single week learning about these other vehicles so I can earn about 4 to 6% per year on my money. And I was taking away time from a business that was growing at a rate of 10 to 30% per month. So it's super important that you understand that concept before you get into this. But then it's very important that you do not work for money. And what that means is your time is very limited, right? You might, you know, you only have 24 hours in a day, and we all have the same 24 hours in a day. But one thing you have to understand is when you are exchanging your time for money, you're going to cap your potential, right? Because you only have 24 hours. And you might say, well, Bashar, but I can go and be more valuable to the marketplace by, say, becoming a consultant or an attorney or a doctor, where instead of my hour being $10, $20, $30, $50, my hour could be $200, $300, $400. And you're absolutely right. I pay my attorney $730 per hour. So her 24 hours are a lot more valuable than the 24 hours of someone that works at McDonald's and flip burgers. I 100% agree with you. But also, she has a cap at how much she can make, because she's not going to work 24/7. That's number one. She's not going to work 7 days a week, number two. And even if she did work 7 days a week, she's not going to do it forever. She has a family. And when she is out on vacation or is out sick or something happens to her, her income goes down to zero. And that's when you have to figure out vehicles that you can make sure that you're not exchanging time for money. And for me, that was Amazon FBA. And this is why I started selling on Amazon. Because whether you sell one unit per day or sell 1,000 units per day, your job as a business owner does not change, right? Your job as a business owner just simply does not change. The second thing is, it's about how much you keep. You guys probably hear me talk a lot about, you know, flexing and you know, talking badly about people that flex and stuff like that. And let me explain. I've got nothing against people that like to wear nice clothes and like to spend a lot of money on things and all that stuff. There's absolutely nothing wrong with it. If that's what makes you feel good about yourself, great, do it. And actually, here's a little story. But before I go into that story, if you're finding this video valuable so far, and if it is your first time, please smash the thumbs up button and consider subscribing to the channel, as we drop videos like those every single week. So Donald Trump, love him or hate him, said that one of his friends, very early on in his career, although the friend wasn't wealthy or anything, he said the friend used to always, regardless where he flew to, he used to always sit in first class. He's like, this guy just didn't have it like that. But he would always spend the extra $1,000, $2,000, $3,000, whatever it was, and he would make sure that he sits in first class. And he's like, to him, it was about feel. It wasn't about looking rich, but it was about feeling rich deep down inside. He's like, his mind was tens of years ahead of him financially. In his mind, his bank account had 10 zeros, but his real bank account didn't really have that many zeros. But his mindset was there already. He just needed to catch up his bank account to the reality, right? So if that's what makes you feel good, and I know a lot of people that that truly makes them feel good and that keeps them going, that motivates them, that's great. But at the end of the day, it's not about how much you make, but it's about how much you keep. Because look, you could be making $50,000 a month net, but if you're, you know, if your expenses are 45, you're only really keeping 5,000, and what good is that, right? If you're literally blowing everything, what good is that? So you really have to think about, I want the thing, you know, I want to buy the thing, and I want to do that because it makes me feel good. But then at the end of the day, you know, what are my long-term goals? And that's what you really need to be thinking about. What are my long-term goals? And what, like, what do I want to accomplish in life? Because look, money is important, and I'm a big advocate for it, right? But materialistic possessions will only add, in my opinion, add weight to your life and add volume to your life that you don't need because they're not truly valuable. Again, if they help you keep going, great, do it, but always think about how much am I keeping, not how much am I making. To me, a rule of thumb is that your expenses should not be more than 10% of your total revenue. So if you're, you know, if you want to fly private and if you want to have a Rolex and be driving a Lamborghini, Rolls Royce or whatever, great. If that makes up only 10% of your income, go do it. If it doesn't, then don't do it and work on increasing your income until you can get to the 10% and then do it. Third thing is less taxes. You see, regardless where you live in the world, right? The government is just not as good as building infrastructure and doing the right thing for its citizens. And the government realizes that. Therefore, the government actually gives incentives to business owners, to business people, to entrepreneurs, and rewards them for doing what the government cannot do, which is providing housing, which is why a lot of people invest in real estate after they've made all of their money. Which is why, as a business owner, you could write off a whole bunch of stuff before you pay taxes. But as an employee, the government takes away their taxes before they give you the paycheck. I can write off, I can make $1 million per year, but only pay taxes on $50,000 if I can show legally that I am truly, all these other things are expenses. Where you as an employee could make $1 million per year, but pay taxes on, you know, pay probably, I would say, a third or even half of that in taxes simply because the government does not trust you. As a business owner, they trust you because you're making the economy and society a better place. You're providing employment for people. You are building something, and you're growing yourself and you're growing society. And because we live in such a economical world, these things are important to the government, so they reward you. So you paying extra taxes does not make any sense. In fact, our company could be profiting millions of dollars and pay zero in taxes legally because there are vehicles that are very expensive that will make that happen. And that's how Jeff Bezos and Elon Musk and Donald Trump and all these guys make billions of dollars but pay zero in taxes simply because the government rewards them for R&D. They reward them for all these different, you know, mechanisms because they are putting back into society and they are help improving society. But just imagine if Elon Musk wasn't there, if Mark Zuckerberg wasn't there, if Jeff Bezos wasn't there, although, you know, love them or hate them, but how much have they truly impacted the world that we live in today? Imagine if Facebook wasn't there. How would you be talking to your relatives that are, you know, on the other side of the world? If Amazon wasn't there, how would shopping even look like today, right? So really think about that. So again, this is legal. All right, the fourth thing is the end game. You know, and this is really important. And sometimes it's very mind-boggling. When I learned it, when I realized it, everything shifted for me. A lot of people look at McDonald's and say, that's a burger joint. You know, McDonald's is a burger joint. They, you know, their system, which is pretty excellent, they have perfected a system. They license it. They franchise it. The franchisee pays them an upfront investment to pretty much to buy their systems, and they also pay them royalties. But then the company controls, you know, everything, and they control the material and everything else, right? But you see, McDonald's is really not in the business of burgers. McDonald's, wait for it. Actually, you know what? Why don't you guess it and drop it in the comments? I'm going to give you like 10 seconds. Drop it in the comments. What do you think McDonald's is in the business of? And they're not in the business of making burgers. So type that, drop it in the comments right now. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. They are in the business of real estate. Real estate. Because you see, when McDonald's opens a new branch, they buy the real estate. So what they're doing is they are buying the real estate, say at 10%. So let's say they buy a branch at a store, a location. Let's say it's worth $2 million. They put 10 to 20% down payment, which is say it's 20%, that's $400,000. And then they let the franchisee who's paying them the royalty to pay down that mortgage. So they simply, after 10 or 20 or 30 years, would have owned a $2 million property for only $400,000 of cash, and maybe even less, because, you know, McDonald's probably gets loans from everywhere and anyone loans them money because they're so good at paying it back, right? So that's their end game. Their end game is not burgers. They use burgers to own real estate. And in fact, McDonald's is the world's largest real estate holding company, right? So what McDonald's has done is it has perfected a system, and they use that system to simply, you know, pay for real estate or have other people pay for real estate, right? So when you are coming to an opportunity, you always have to think about, what is my end game? What do I want to accomplish? I want to start selling on Amazon. Great. But what do I want that money to accomplish for me? I want to make $10,000 per month. Great. But why? There's always a why. There's always something that's tied up behind the thing that you want right now. And if you don't know what that thing is, you really want to start thinking about it, because that will change how you look at the opportunity. That will change how you treat the opportunity. That will change how far you take the opportunity. Thinking about the why and the end game and the long-term game is very important when you start in something. And that might be not very evident for you. You know, when I first started selling on Amazon, I didn't have an end game. I didn't have anything. I was just in debt, and I was in survival mode, and I needed a business. I needed something, any type of vehicle that'll help me get out of debt. And that's it. That's the only thing was that I was thinking about. But over time, I started developing these things. So this is very important for you to understand, right? And number five, and I personally love and appreciate this very much. And again, if you have not read the book Rich Dad Poor Dad, you definitely want to read it. Get the physical copy and read it. But then most importantly, smash thumbs up button and subscribe to the channel if you haven't already. So number five is creating opportunities. You see, in today's economy, in today's society, there are more ways to make money than ever. And it is so much easier to make money than ever. Imagine, you know, like, if you can start a business on Amazon with less than $10,000 and become profitable in year one, imagine this, a similar concept 100 years ago, 30 years ago, right? Imagine how much more difficult it would have been to try to do that. Anybody from anywhere can open a seller's account on Amazon, can ship products to Amazon, can start making sales on Amazon. Anybody, anywhere. I don't care who you are, right? So the question that I always ask is, like, the question, not the question, but the complaint that I always hear people say is, but I just don't know where to start. I just don't know what to do. I've tried so many things and nothing has worked before. And you know, every time I try to do something, I've gotten scammed so many times and I just don't believe anybody. And you know, like, or I see people that are stuck in a job that they hate, and yet you see other people that literally with just a few little things are able to accomplish amazing things. What's the difference? The difference is Winners and rich dad creates opportunity while poor people and victim mentality people wait for opportunity to show up. It's like, you know that saying, the patients are rewarded or something like that, or something, I don't know what the saying is, but it's something like, if you're patient, you will be rewarded because an opportunity will present itself. And although that's important, that you need to be patient, that you shouldn't be reactive, that you shouldn't just jump into everything you see, but also it's important that you don't wait for people to spoon feed you, because no successful story out there, Robert Kiyosaki did not wait for opportunity to present itself. He went out there, he was knocking on doors, he was making door-to-door sales, he was picking up calls, he was cold calling people, he was doing all this stuff. So again, for you, the same thing. When I lost my business, you know, I didn't wait for, you know, I cried a little bit and I blamed some people, but then things did not change for me until I took responsibility, because that's really the only time you can actually move forward. If you look, if I say it's your fault that my glasses broke, right? I cannot do anything about that because you broke my glasses. There's nothing I can do about this. But if I say it's because of me, you had access to break my glasses, I could do something about that. I can take the glasses, next glasses, and I can put them somewhere where you don't have access to them so you can't break them. You see, when I took responsibility for you breaking my glasses, I was able to do something about it. But when I put the responsibility on you, I cannot control you to not touch my next pair of glasses. So it's very important that you take control and take responsibility for everything that's happening to you, because it's not about what happens to you, it's about how you react to it, right? So that's really important, and it ties back down to creating your own, you know, your own opportunities. When I lost my restaurant, I could have gotten a job and I could have just said, you know what, this is it, I'm done. That's it, right? And gone through that route. But I took responsibility. I would drive around 5 to 6 hours every single day to different stores around town when I found a product that I could make a profit on Amazon. So what I would do is I would go to stores, scan literally aisles upon aisles upon aisles, hundreds of products every single day, and then see how I had a specific criteria, and then see what kind of profits I could make if I flipped them on Amazon. And that's how I got started for the first 6 months. That's what I did. The first 3 months I drove around stores and I realized that it wasn't scalable. So I went online. I started shopping in other, you know, stores, TJ Maxx. I went to this store, I went to that store. And then I would buy them, I would pack them, and I would ship them to Amazon, and Amazon would fulfill. And then I realized that private label was an easier, faster way to scale, because now I had some money to play around with. So then I got involved with private label. I launched a couple of products, they failed. And then I took a course and I saw what I was what I was missing. And then I was able to fix those problems and then keep scaling. This was 6 years ago, right? Oftentimes people only see the glory, but they do not see the shit that happened before the currents to get to the glory, right? So if you are somebody who wants to, you know, who's ready to make a change, who's ready to come out of the comfort zone, who's ready to take risks, invest in themselves, and want to do something really valuable with their lives, and you believe that Amazon FBA is the way to do it, I want to invite you to watch a short 20-minute presentation. Click the link in the below this video. It'll take you to a page, watch it. Then if you like what you see, you can book a one-on-one session with one of our enrollment advisors. But before you do that, you have to fill out a short survey and you'll have to qualify for that call. And then on the call, they'll answer your questions and then figure out if we can help you and if our system works for you. And if it is, they'll extend an invitation to BJK University. But outside of that, I hope you enjoyed this video. Hope to see you in the next video. Keep smashing. Take care.